So thank you again. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our speakers for today. Our first speaker is Dr. Jeffrey Morgan. He is a professor of medical science and engineering from Brown University, and his talk today is titled, Can We Build Organs? So please give him a hand.
And congratulations to Russ and the team. It's quite remarkable that what you're doing here, STEM to schools. Yeah, you should be applauded. This is an amazing effort on your part. You know, STEM people are the keepers of the facts and the developers of new facts, and we need facts now. So it's very important to keep going on the trajectory that you're going on. When I came, was invited to talk, I live in Sharon, I'm just down the road a little bit. I said, well, what was I doing when I was a high school student? So I dug out this old photograph, and it was, wow. It really kind of was very sobering. So clearly the hairstyle has changed, and the ties have gotten a little thinner, but I would have liked to said I was thinking about science in those days, but I wasn't. And it wasn't until I went to college that I got excited about science. And it's a graduate student that turned me on to it. I had a job as a work-study student washing test tubes, and that student, Russ Tracy, I'll never forget him because he started to explain to me science. I ended up doing research in the lab and then went on to fairly exciting career that I've really enjoyed over the years. But so you're way ahead of the game here because you're far ahead of where I was at that age, and you're much better dressers than I was in those days. But the talk, my title of my talk, and I'll tell you the answer right now, can we build organs? And the answer is no. And so each and every one of you should sign up to be an organ donor because, in fact, the medical need for organs is tremendous. But my job here is to sort of tell you about what may happen, what may come, what does the future hold? And I submit that your generation will be the generation that actually solves this problem, builds organs in one way or another. And I think the proof is with my co-speaker here because her talk's very exciting because her company is selling organs, selling skin, which, you know, 20 years ago would have been unheard of. But, you know, so the progress really continues. So my job as a professor is to, of course, train the next generation, educate the next generation, hopefully inspire the next generation. And we do that by doing research in the lab. So when you do go off to college, try to make every opportunity to get yourself into a research lab because it's an amazing place to learn. It's great for people who learn by doing things. That was what always excited me. The book learning, okay, sure, I get that, but learning by doing is such a powerful experience. So, I won't go on and on. Professor, I could lecture for hours, but Russ has told me to keep it to like 30 minutes, and I'll try my best. Talk is going to look like this. I'd like to outline for you the grand challenge of organ engineering. And then I'd like to tell you about two projects that we've been doing at Brown University so that you get a flavor for the kinds of things that are being done. You know, many labs around the world are trying to tackle this particular problem. And it's a tough one, and there are different approaches to it. So as I was telling Russ and Kelvin before the talk, we're not sure who's going to win the race. We're not sure what technology will prevail. Let's get started. So, sort of the first question is, a human being, how many cells are you? I mean, you probably know how many DNA base pairs you are at this point. Does anybody know how many base pairs in your DNA? Yeah, Zach?
6 billion.
Yeah, Brad. The B, yeah.
Yeah,
the billion. So how many human cells are we? 70 kilogram man is sort of the standard. So the answer is actually 37 trillion cells, which is a pretty extraordinary number. And then if you break that down, and there was a wonderful paper, you can't really see the author there, but you break it down into its components, we have blood, bone marrow, skin, which you're going to hear about, and we have billions and trillions, and you can see that by far, you're mostly blood, 26 trillion cells, and blood donations happen all the time. And skin, we've already commercialized that, and it's grown and used to repair burns and chronic ulcers of the skin. But the organs that need to be engineered are the following, what I call the big four: the liver, kidney, heart, and pancreas. And you can see the numbers of cells are still sizable, but within reason. So one thing about this problem is, if you begin to define what the problem is, it doesn't seem so impossible, although these are big numbers. The cost. So you might wonder, well, how much would it cost to grow all these cells? And Dr. Pitkin could probably update some of these numbers, but nowadays people are growing cells, mesenchymal stem cells, in a big bioreactors, costing about $1 to $5 per million cells. And so you can see that the cost of these organs, if we were just to grow them, isn't too prohibitive. And if you think of, like, computer memory, how expensive that was and how cheap it's become, there's a similar analogy. As technology develops, it's going to get cheaper and cheaper as more people work on it. So that's very encouraging. The time to grow all these cells, how long do you think it would take to grow all the cells in a human organ? You know, so we can start with a sort of theoretical problem that as you take a single cell, it divides every 24 hours, human cell bacteria is every 20 minutes, human cells are every 24 hours. If you just do sort of simple math and you look at, like, well, here's the number of cells as a function of time, it's not that crazy. It's not that far out. So along the way, you have enough cells for a pancreas, a heart, kidney, liver, and skin, and then an entire adult human. So again, defining the problem with respect to some of the numbers helps you begin to see that it's not out of this world. It's not an impossibility. And I think all of this is very important. Now, I see a very interesting poster over there on stem cells. And I don't know if you've been following the field, but there's an absolute amazing breakthrough in something called induced pluripotent stem cells. Those are cells. This is a discovery that's already been awarded the Nobel Prize. It's really shaken up the field. And suffice it to say, it's the ability to take a cell, a skin cell, from an old guy like me, and then reprogram it so it goes from skin cell to primitive cell. And once you go to primitive cell, then they've figured out the cocktails and growth factors to make that cell go from primitive cell to differentiated cell. Liver cell, kidney cell, heart cell. Absolute breakthrough. Happening, labs all over the world are working on this feverishly because they realize this is the raw materials, if you will, for building organs. And the ability to grow these cells, they have tremendous growth potential. This lab at Berkeley showed that these cells will double 20-fold every 4 days or 10 days, and so here's the trajectory. So in fact, this begins to tell you, we not only is it reasonable with respect to time and money, but also the raw materials are starting to fall into place. So the grand challenge, as I see it, is really quite interesting. As I said, we're not there yet. Every one of you should sign up to be an organ donor. It's very important. But here are the things that make me very excited about this. The medical need is great, so labs will be working on it all the time. And at the point where organs are engineered, I think it's going to be a major breakthrough. It's a real game changer with respect to medical care. We have the raw materials. These raw materials are being grown in large numbers. The cost of these raw materials will decline. The alchemy, as I call it, the various growth factors and additives to drive cells to differentiate or transform from a primitive cell to a liver cell, is all getting worked out, labs all over the world, some of them right up in Boston. Now, there are multiple approaches to this problem, as you might imagine, and I'll talk a little bit about them, but there are genetically engineered pigs in Boston that are trying to engineer organs, that is, engineer them genetically so that the immune rejection problem, that the organs from these pigs could be transplanted to humans. Okay? So that's a very viable approach. Each of these has its difficulties, but that one may win, who knows? There are attempts to regenerate organs directly in the human. If you remember your mythology, Prometheus, who brought the fire, the gods took away his liver and it keeps regenerating. So there is this regenerative potential that can take place. Manufacture ex vivo. So we have a great example here with skin. There are multiple technologies working in this space. And this is the area that my lab at Brown University has been working on for a number of years now. So what I'd like to do is sort of share with you in the next few minutes a couple of the technologies that we've been working with. The first is a micromold system. We use this to form living building parts. And of course, molding is actually an ancient technology. It's nothing too fancy. I think it's probably, over 2,000-3,000 years old. They were molding metals and whatnot. So sometimes these inventions are pretty simple. And the more simple, the better. So, with my graduate students in the lab, we actually invented this technology where we have these tiny little posts. We pour in this molten agarose. Agarose is like a gel material, kind of like gelatin. And once it cools down, it forms this gel. We take it out of the mold, and into this chamber, we add living cells. And then I'll show you how the device actually works. So we take out the agarose, we culminate it in the cell culture media, the broth, the goodies that cells need to grow. We then fill this chamber with cells. They then settle by gravity to the bottom of these tiny little microwells down here. And it's actually the opposite of a Petri dish that you've probably worked with. You know, Petri dishes are there for cells to attach to. This is a dish made of a material that cells don't attach to. So what happens is the cells begin to stick to each other, adhere, and they actually self-assemble little microtissues at the bottom of each of the wells, schematically shown here. Now, let me show you a time-lapse video of this. So we set this up on our microscope in the lab. Add the cells, they settle to the little wells, and this is going to loop over a 20-hour period. These are human mesenchymal stem cells that are aggregating and forming little clusters of cells, about 1,000 cells or so per little microtissue. Now, this is really quite remarkable because, first of all, it's very easy, and second of all, it's something that you can scale up. So the notion I want to put in your head today is that we view these as building parts. These little chunks of tissue, we're going to try to assemble them into something that maybe begins to look like it might be a tissue or organ. Okay? We have a ways to go. So one of the things we need to do is be able to scale up. And so here's a whole bunch of gels that could make about 2,000 or so spheroids, these little clusters of cells. And of course, we can get lots of those plates, begin to get the number of cells that are getting up there. We know these little spheroids are really quite remarkable. because if you mix two cell types, here they're red and they're green, and as they self-assemble, these cells are self-sorting. They kind of know where to go. So one cell type goes to the center, the other cell type goes to the outside. They do this, we don't do anything other than count the cells and put them in there. So the biology is kind of driving this. We can't control that. I'd love to be able to control that, tell one cell type go here and one cell type go there. We have different mixtures of cells we can make. We have another, I'll show you another slide here when it queues up. So here we go. Queue back up. There's always a big file. Well, this one's not going to play, but right here is a cardiomyocyte. These are heart cells. So you can form these little heart cells into a little microtissue, and they'll start to spontaneously beat on their own, and you can actually electrically pace them. And so it's a living little tissue, so it's really quite remarkable. It's kind of creepy, actually, that they're beating in these little dishes. And they'll form all kinds of structures, so this amazing biology that will play out. So you begin to get the sense, hey, yeah, maybe he's not that far out. Maybe there's possibilities here of building with these tissues. Oh, there it goes. It shows you some of the cells will form these hollow structures all on their own. And if you watch that carefully, you'll see it twitch every so often, which is the cardiomyocytes kind of beginning to try to beat. So why not just make really big spheroids. Take a whole bunch of cells and make a big spheroid. Why couldn't we do that? What would be lacking? Yes, sir.
Because like cells don't want to sit next to each other if there's so many of them. Like gravity would pull them apart.
They would pull them apart?
But like just the little, because like cells probably only want to assemble in like groups of 1,000. If you get much more than that.
Yeah, if you get too big, what's going to happen? There's an important concept here. Because you could get, yes, go ahead, you're close.
Stop reproducing if there's too many of them?
Yeah, they get limited for certain things. They get nutrient limited, right? So what happens is that these are passive structures. There's no vascular system. There's no heartbeat. There's no blood vessels, right? The heart is beating, it's pumping blood through all the organs and tissues. They're consuming oxygen and nutrients. And so the tissues that are made now, like the skin, they live off of diffusion. So diffusion is this, if you imagine you have an aquarium and you take some food coloring and you put a little drop in there, it's green over the corner, and over about an hour it's going to diffuse. Very passive process. But if you're mixing it, that's called convection. It'll mix really fast, and you can get that blue or that glucose molecule over to the other side. And that's what your heart does, pumping it through. So what we started to play around with was, let's make different types of building parts. And the thickness of a tissue that can live by diffusion alone is on the order of about 200 microns thick. And so we started making donuts, and now we have diffusion. We have this hole in the donut. You'll see becomes kind of important. We can make molds, make donut structures. We can make donuts that have a larger size as long as we keep that thickness of tissue on the order of 200 microns. And then, we can think of donuts in a horizontal plane. And that structure is pretty simple. It's a honeycomb. So a series of holes, and now we have a honeycomb building part, self-assembled, same amount of time, less than 24 hours. And now instead of 1,000 cells, we have 250,000 cells. So it's a 250-fold increase over the size of a single building part. So we're beginning to try to scale up ever so gently. Now how are we going to put these together? Oh, we're going to have glue and put them in there? Well, it turns out that is one approach, but it turns out these structures are living structures, let's not forget that. And if you bring two of them together, like these two little spheroids, this time lapse shows you that they actually spontaneously fuse. So as a building material, it's kind of self-welding, comes together. So we're exploring that larger and larger structures. And it's true for not only those little spheres, it's also true for the donuts. If we bring two together, they form this figure eight. If we stack them and look on the side, they'll fuse into a structure. So this is a spontaneous process that takes place. And the lab is investigating that at the molecular level, try to understand what's going on. But then we got this idea, well, maybe we could build with it. And so we came up with this device, which we call the BioPick Place and Perfuse. And we borrowed this device from the electronics industry because pick and place is an old technology for making integrated circuits, where a robot goes, picks up something, and places it real fast. Okay? So we said, let's borrow that idea, let's bring it into biology, call it bio, because that makes it cool, pick and place, and then perfuse. So perfuse, probably a perhaps a new word to you, is what basically pump fluid through it. Pretend we have a little heart. We use a mechanical pump to pump fluid. And so here's the concept. Here's our building part. We're going to stack them up and pump fluid through the holes of these little parts. And so we have a little pump, that syringe pump that just comes down, grabs this part, brings it over, stacks it, goes and gets another one, and then we pump fluid through this whole stack. Now, you probably always see talks where the finished product is done. The thing about technology is it's always ugly in the beginning, okay? The first computers would fill this room. You know, now they're in your pocket. So in our mind, this was version 1.0. Here it is, pretty ugly looking, cluttered. I borrowed this pump from my chairman. There's some Home Depot stuff there. But the concept, which was what was powerful, this device, it was manually operated. I had two students that were working on this, and they would get frustrated. I said, no, it's going to work, it's going to work. And they made it work. Based on this ugly little thing, I got a $1.2 million grant from the National Science Foundation to build version 2.0. And that's some serious cash, which is very exciting. But before I show you that, here's a close-up of this thing. There's the little gripper. There's some of the building parts. That's the gripper. And we actually made this stack. Oh, here it is in motion. So you're gonna get two, so we had cameras. Right, so you got a camera looking down. Here's the camera looking down, and a camera looking from the side. So these are synchronized movies. So you'll see this going. What's going to happen? And I'll try to narrate this. Is it's going to come down? It's going to grip the part by sucking fluid. It's going to stick on the membrane, and then we're going to move it over and stack it. So hopefully this video. Here it goes. It's coming down. Just grab the part, you see that? Now it's pulled it up, and now it's headed over here, and there's a stack already of these little honeycombs, and then it's gonna come down, and it's gonna place it on there, let it go, and remember, those tissues are alive, so they're gonna fuse. They're fusing into one little small stack of living tissue. And we got very excited by that. So here's our building parts. There's our gripper. There's our stack from a side view. Stack of 20 honeycombs, and we got 7.5 million cells because we're keeping our eye on this. As I said, we got this great grant from the National Science Foundation. So we built this thing, which is really cool. It's in a sterile hood. All kinds of cool stuff happening in here. We've got pumps. We've got things to keep the tissue alive, semi-automated. there's a fill box, here's the tissue, camera looking down, and this, let me see if this video will play for you. This, a student drew this in SolidWorks so that you get a sense of what's going on. We don't have the dramatic music yet, but we'll get that. And so there it is, showing it has control around the X and the Y and the Z dimensions, and then theta, rotation around Z. Sure, geometry is very important. And there it was. It's going to now grip apart, going to come down. Fluid suction picks it up, brings it over here. There's the build head. And we're making these names up as we're going along. We're building this thing, so we get to call it whatever we want. It's got to make sense, of course. And then rotation around Z brings it down, puts it in place, goes and gets another one, and you can just do this sort of all day long, okay? So when you're innovating, it's very exciting because you really don't know what's going on. I tell the students all the time, we're just making this up. Like, oh, Professor Morgan, what are we supposed to do? I don't know. Well, we're making it up. So the thing that's exciting and is this whole rig, and it's a team of people with different skill sets, biologists, engineers, machinists, very talented guy who used to work at Hasbro Children's Hospital, John Murphy, building all kinds of cool stuff. And he basically, the best part about this is the whole thing is driven by an Xbox controller. So when your parents say you're wasting your time playing video games, you say, no, you're getting ready to go work at Professor Morgan's lab because his pick and place is driven by an Xbox controller. Literally controls X, Y, Z, turns on the pumps, off the pumps, controls it the whole bit, and then the video cameras are on the computer screen. So we're using this to build tissues on a regular basis. We made even bigger parts. We now have 2 centimeters across. There's a really big honeycomb, 1.5 times 10 to the 7 cells in that single part. And a whole part of the lab is just trying to figure out how to keep these parts alive. What are the fluid mechanics of gripping and depositing it? What's the simulation of consumption of nutrients and fluid flow and shear stress in this built tissue? And then here's one of our bigger ones. This is a stack of 20 layers, 1 times 10 to the 7 cells per layer. And you can see we have this radiator-like structure. Now, this doesn't look anything like an organ, okay? But what we're doing is trying to understand how to keep a chunk of tissue alive, very cell dense, lots of nutrients, because that's the building block for trying to build something even more complex. I tell the students, the Wright brothers, when they flew for like, oh, I don't know, what was it, like 15 seconds or something, they weren't serving peanuts, okay? They were just, you know, starting, taking a small step. And that's how science gets done. That's how technologies get developed. So we're excited by this. We look at the tissue structure. We measure the production of liver-specific proteins as a function of time. And our largest to date is a stack of about 350 million cells. It does pretty well for about 3 or 4 days, and then it starts to crash. Now we got to figure out what's going on. What aren't we supplying? What do the cells need? We know they need a lot of stuff, but understanding that, this gives us a platform to figure those things out. So I hope I didn't go too much over my time. I apologize to my fellow speakers, but I want to leave you with a sense of excitement. I want, you know, my job is to hand this off to the next generation, which I think is sitting right here. I submit we have the raw materials, the building blocks can be assembled, they have cell density that equals organs, they have this self-organizing biological architecture. We can control the part shape by the mold design, so you can come up with any kind of crazy idea. By all means, you should always, you know, think outside the box. Our spheroids, 1,000 cells, we've now gone up to 10 to the 7 cells. Takes about 24 hours to fuse these. We're on version 2.0. We're already thinking about what 3.0 is going to look like. And just to bring it back to the perspective, how far away are we from building an organ or a tissue? Gives you a sense, here's liver. With this kind of a part, about 30,000 parts. A kidney, about 1,000 parts, 600, 300. These are not impossible numbers. These are not crazy numbers. And I suspect we'll just get better and better at this, and some other lab will come up with another breakthrough of some sort, where we'll adopt that into our technology as well. Because all these technologies begin to merge and cross-fertilize and inspire each other. So there are a bunch of challenges, milestones ahead. Organs are far more complex than just the sheer number of cells. I don't have to tell this group, you know, the kidney does a lot of important stuff, the heart is a monster pump, the liver is a big detoxification. New technologies, we need to be able to form vasculature, you have to design this for implantation, you got to be able to make this thing, take it out of it, the bioreactor, and hand it to a surgeon so that she can stitch it right in there and it's, you know, delivered blood supply. We'd love to figure out how to grow these things in the bioreactor. Start with a small one and have it grow bigger. Anybody got any ideas on that? Love to hear them. There's multiple cell types. The cost has to come down. At some point, we'll begin to make some partial successes, some first clinical successes, and then the whole field will just explode with respect to technology. So, I'm just the front man. Folks that do the work here, I've been fortunate to work with a whole bunch of great students, from fellow professors to PhD students to undergraduates, Jackie Shell, Christine Nolan, Kaylee Manning, Andrew Blakely did the first version 1.0, Blanchett, and John Murphy were working on version 2.0. Michael did great work at Fusion. He's now got a great job up at Millipore. Ben Wilkes is in the lab, and he's working on new, exciting building parts. Frank and Bob are our modeler guys. They're like in the virtual world, so they just do all these really cool simulations. Because experiments can be hard if you can simulate it. You can do a lot of things in simulation and test them. Before you go into actually testing it and growing the tissue. So I've got a bunch of funding sources, National Science Foundation, National Institute of Health. These are your tax dollars I'm spending, hopefully wisely. So thank you for supporting science. And I have an equity interest in MicroTissues Inc., which actually sells those little green devices, and I have to disclose that. But yeah, thanks for your attention, and I'm happy to take questions. Oh no, questions at the end, right, Russ?
Yeah, yeah. We're gonna have a.